everyone. Please keep eating. All right, I am so excited to be here today. This is like my absolute favorite show. And I am, as promised, gonna tell you a little bit about our Omnibus Report, which is our third time doing it, the audience of one, the marketer, and the machine. But before I do that, I'm gonna tell you a little bit about Movable Ink. So we have the pleasure of working with the world's largest and most innovative brands, including a little company called Amazon, Walmart, Home Depot, Expedia, Hilton, Delta, and American Express over there, Chase and Citibank. And we activate customer data into personalized content across email and mobile. And what does that look like in action? Well, it looks like Amex offers, it looks like Gary's new release email, and it looks like that famed Spotify Wrapped email that Jamie brought up before. And just by way of personal introduction, I just crossed my 11th year with Movable Ink. I am really proud of that. Thank you, yes. And there is nowhere I would rather be to celebrate that than with you, my friends in industry. No, I mean it. I've actually been in email, if you can believe it, for 23 years. Yes, I'm dating myself, but I joined email. I've been in email mostly on and off, but mostly on, since graduating college in 2000. Way back when, email was actually a division of direct mail. I joined the team at Ogilvy Interactive, and I was on the Jaguar Cars account, and we were probably sending a lot of emails to AOL accounts back then. But it was makes sense that it was a division of direct mail, because it was then. It was the tail end of the dot-com boom, and it was still a sort of vestige of database marketing. Who was in the industry back then? Who remembers this time? Yes, hello, my friends. And the good news was that there was a real shift coming, and we were moving into this part of the ecosystem. And there were a lot of investments into mobile and social, and I'll confess, I got distracted by new shiny things, and I went to work in those ecosystems. But don't worry, I saw the light, and I came back into email, which is, of course, the most important channel. And then a new decade came, and there were lots of investments into systems of intelligence. And it was all about what was above us in the cloud, and a lot of investments into CDPs. I was just overhearing Chris Marriott was leading a really interesting roundtable over there and talking about CDPs. But here we are. We're at the verge of this very exciting new era, which is arguably going to be the most defining new era for all of our careers, which is, of course, systems of autonomy. And we're going to experience what is going to be the most interesting one for all of our careers. We're going to be working with truly AI-powered platforms, and we're going to have a chance to work with them personally. And what's so interesting is that, you know, I started out in systems of awareness as a young millennial, and now we're seeing the generation that's really embracing this the most, which is, of course, Gen Z. And it's really reminiscent of how, you know, other generations were so quick to embrace the internet and social, like their lives and their jobs depended on it. And maybe, I don't know, maybe they do, because what our report proves is that marketers are already embracing AI-enabled marketing platforms, and it's not just a fad, it's not just a trend. And we've seen that marketers are embracing this at every part of the marketing stack, from campaign management to creative production processes, and seeing tremendous results, like the ones that Ryan shared, and that Gary shared also. And of course, with every shift in a tectonic plate in a part of technology, there are going to be concerns and trepidations. But what our report showed is that marketers are meeting the moment already, and more on that later. What I wanted to start out with today is to see how many of you in the room are already using AI in production. I thought it was so interesting to see how much Gary is already doing across already different parts of his tech stack. But how many of you are using it in 2023, not thinking about it for 2024? Show of hands. Okay, great, so many. Danielle, I know you're eating, but tell us, what are you doing already?
Wait, hang on.
Yeah,
we have people actually watching from home. But this is on the record.
Oh, Danielle from Macy's. For AI, just dipping our toes in, we just recently partnered with Frazee, so they're powering all of our subject lines.
Awesome.
Getting into in-body copy so that we can, you know, make our copy more relevant to our customers using AI.
Great. That's a great use case. Awesome. Who else had their hand up? Come on, don't be shy.
Hold on. Arena here.
Mine will be the same. It's Frazee. We've been using them for 3 years for subject lines.
3 years. Alrighty. So you're an early adopter. All right, great. Well, so our survey showed that 97% of marketers across the US and the UK are already using AI in some form of their marketing stack. So let's dive into where they're using it. So it wasn't really a surprise to see that they're using it in places where there are large tracts of data where they really can adopt technology to consume and really crunch those numbers, like consumer behavior analysis, data insights, and SEO. But what we thought was so interesting is that more than a quarter of marketers are already using it on content creation, which is so interesting because, of course, Gary showed this, that he's already using this in production as well. And obviously, that's an area where there's a lot of trepidation, and I think Morgan even had a question about this, like, but what about the IP concerns? But of course, marketers are already under so many pressures and stresses, and so why not give this process some trial and error, right? And see what you come up with and put this into production. And what are those pressures and stresses, you might ask? Well, we on the front lines of Movable Ink are talking about this all the time on the strategy team, and I think one thing that we note is that they have ratcheted up considerably since COVID, and they never came back down, right? They went up probably like 4 to 5x. The pace of change just became almost dizzying. And here's what we see across vertical. Balancing long-term strategy with short-term trends, quickly adapting to match customer preferences, and implementing necessary changes in a timely manner. Thanks, compliance. Do these look familiar? So I would ask you, why would any marketing team in any economy choose to go to market without all of the AI tools at their disposal? It just doesn't make any sense. So of course you would think about using AI-enabled content. And so that's why it wasn't a surprise to see that 50% of marketers are already turning over their campaign management process to AI-enabled tools. And you think about all of the multitude of steps that are involved in the campaign management process, which we see on a daily basis, usually involve multiple parties, sometimes across disparate teams, and let's be honest, they sometimes use Excel. I'm gonna be honest, I see it. I get sent them. It's okay, your secret's safe with me. But you can begin to do things that humans just can't possibly process, and I'm gonna call it Gen Z, the Gen Zers on your team that make up 40% of the workforce right now, they'd say that's pretty basic. So yes, let's turn that over to an AI-powered platform and you can manage so much more. And the benefits are abundant. Those AI-enabled marketers report back that they span across content personalization, segmentation and targeting, and content ideation and sentiment analysis. And again, those AI-enabled marketing teams report that they are then enabled to focus so much more on strategy. And isn't that what we got into this business for in the beginning? And Ryan spoke at Brand Insider Summit. By the way, wasn't Ryan's presentation amazing? Can we just give him another round of applause? Yes. So when he spoke at Brand Insider Summit a few months ago, he said, if you went to like every single person on your team and you said, oh, hey, just quick question, do you have too much on your plate and would you like to focus more on strategy? Every single person on your team would put their hand up, yes. So that is in fact what happens here with AI-enabled tools. And so if there's one takeaway from this research report and this presentation that you get today, it's that AI-enabled marketers report that they have 56% more time to focus on strategy, 53% improved personalization efforts, and 50% production efficiencies. So if you're looking for new heads and your budget is flat, here, I just found you some people. You're welcome. Okay, so I talked about those concerns that happen when there is a tectonic shift in any marketing era and the concerns that marketers have or that really anybody has in an ecosystem. And I mentioned my like dalliance in other channels when I went to work in mobile, and for a while I was like the mobile evangelist at American Express, which is a really fun job. And people would come up to me in the cafeteria, people would come up to me at cocktail parties and be like, oh my God, mobile, it's like a scourge. I'm worried about my kids going to school with their mobile device. My husband's like on his phone in bed. Like people are like addicted to mobile. And I'd say like, sounds more like a people problem, not like a technology problem, but like, I don't know, what do I know? So people have concerns, and here's what they're reporting. They're concerned about privacy invasions, about IP issues. They're concerned about an absence of human oversight. Again, sounds like a human problem. Okay, but the good news is that unlike the headlines that you might have been reading, marketers are meeting the moment. And you heard about that a little bit in Ryan's excellent presentation. Here's how they're responding right now. They're actively monitoring for bias to make sure that the content created by these tools are not perpetuating harmful stereotypes. They're already implementing checks and balances to make sure that the content created is upholding brand standards that you have invested untold fortunes and decades to create. And again, you heard Ryan talk about creating those mandated human reviews at the end of a process to make sure that there's checks and balances along the way. And that's about the marketer and the machine coming together to do things that are just not possible with human intelligence alone. It's about the marketer and the machine working together to do more than would be possible with one alone. Now, I brought a use case that's an anonymized use case to show you what DaVinci looks like, but I'm gonna be honest, I think Ryan stole my thunder, but I'm up here, so I'm gonna finish the presentation. And I think I'll start out by just orienting you to where DaVinci sits within our platform. DaVinci is, of course, our AI platform that has been in market for about 2 years now. It sits adjacent to Studio, which is our real-time data-activated content generation platform that we pioneered in market over 12 years ago. And it pulls in content from all of these partners that are in our exchange and then distributes them across all of these different channels. Now, this use case is from one of America's most storied apparel retailers. Think like Nantucket and the Kennedys, and like, you've got the vibe. And they were the lucky beneficiary of several millions of customers who came to them when they were trying to get a taste of like that outdoorsy life during COVID. And they were coming up on a year on file, and they really wanted to make sure that they didn't attrite, but they didn't want to make sure that they were addicted to discounts. This is a challenge that I know many of the retailers in the room face on a regular basis. So they came to us and were willing to transform their program with DaVinci. But as Ryan said, that is a real transformation for the organization to go through. And they had to really, you know, cut the cord on that addiction to the somewhat arbitrary calendaring process and the manual production process where you are, you know, you're curating a manual email that is then going out into the ether. And they went through that transformation very successfully, where we then were pulling in content that was from their creative library and auto-generating emails. And again, they're still able to create calendar-driven holiday promotions like the 4th of July or back to school that's going into those templates with those blocks that are being, of course, manually created by their creative team still. And they were able to realize these double-digit lifts in click rate, conversion, and revenue, and ultimately realize 1.4 billion personalized sends. That is just a bogglingly large number that no human could ever seek to create manually. I love what Ryan talked about when he talked about human-generated email. I think that when we talk about like your Gen Z teams, in not too long from now, they're probably gonna be sort of sneering at the idea of like, oh, you do human-generated email? Okay, interesting. Yeah, that's probably gonna come up in like an interview process soon. So anyway, ultimately, they were able to totally transform really not just their email program, but fundamentally their business. And these are the kinds of results that we're partnering on with our clients who are working on DaVinci today. If you're interested in getting a taste of these results, we would love to talk to you. So I'm here, I'm gonna be wearing shortly my Movable Pink ski parka. I'm gonna be on the bunny slopes with Rachel. And Adam is going to be doing much more advanced skiing, but we'll all be in the lodge. Also, if you're interested in checking out this report, I can shoot you an email or you can check it out on our website. Thanks so much, guys. Really appreciate being here.